Hello and welcome. My name is Noah Deer, and this is Lesson 5 of PCC's Vector Calculus Math 254 series. This lesson's on parametric surfaces. We are going to be doing some introduction and definitions of what exactly a parametric surface is. It's essentially a vector-valued function, but with two variables, and it's going to give us a 2D surface in three dimensions. We're going to come up with some ways of identifying, plotting these parametric surfaces, essentially some ways of breaking down an equation to be able to figure out what the surface is going to look like, and given a surface, be able to come up with some techniques to try and figure out what the equation is for that. And we will look at how to parameterize the equations of a surface. So if we are described some sort of surface and maybe given an equation in three variables, can we figure out how to come up with the parametric version for the equations of that surface? Right, let's hop in here. Introduction and definitions, 5.1. We've been investigating vector-valued functions in a single variable, such as r of t equals f of t, g of t, h of t. And this gives us a space curve, right? It gives us a one-dimensional object in three dimensions. We now look at vector-valued functions of two variables and note that these will produce two-dimensional objects, surfaces, in three-dimensional space. So I have it written out here. Definition 5.1.1, a parametric surface in three dimensions is the set of all points x, y, z in R, in the set of real numbers, so x, y, and z are all real numbers, satisfying that x equals x of u, comma v, y equals y of u, comma v, and z equals z of u, comma v for two real parameters u and v in some domain D. This surface may be described by a vector function r of u, comma v in two variables. So this is just saying we have the relationship between parametric equations and vector-valued functions. We can think of them as the same thing. Technically, the vector function gives us the arrows that, if we think of them as pointing from the origin, they point to the line if we were doing space curves, and in this case, they would give us arrows that point to the points on the surface, but we just think of the vector-valued function as just the points on the surface. So let's take a look at the next example. Example 5.1.1, given r of u, comma v equals natural log of u times the unit vector I plus the square root of v times the unit vector j plus u times v times the unit vector k, determine and sketch the domain of R. So we're just going to look at the domain for a second. We'll get to how we can, what these look like in the next couple of pages here. So for this function, we see we have a natural log of u. So that tells us that u has to be strictly greater than 0. The square root of v, that shows us that v has to be greater than or equal to 0, since we're just dealing with real numbers. U times v, there's no restrictions here, so our entire domain is going to be determined by these two restrictions. So I can say that d of r equals the set of u, comma v, such that u is greater than 0, and v is greater than or equal to 0. So in our plane here, this is going to show v is greater than or equal to 0 gives us above the u-axis, u is greater than 0 gives us to the right of the v-axis. So we're looking at the first quadrant here. Now v can equal 0, so we can include the u-axis here, but u cannot be 0, so we will not include the origin, and we will not include the v-axis, so we'll use a dotted line to draw that. Okay, simple enough. go ahead and look at exercise 5.1.1, pause the video, and I will come back in just a few moments and work this out with you. And we're back. So here I see from the first component, u times v cannot equal 0, so u cannot equal 0 and v cannot equal 0. The second component is not going to give us any restrictions. The third component gives us that u has to be greater than or equal to 0. This, with the fact that u cannot equal 0, gives us that u has to strictly be greater than 0. Thus, my domain equals the set of points u, v such that u is greater than 0 and v does not equal 0. If I draw this domain, we see that we are in the right half of the plane, so that u is positive. We do not include the v-axis. We do not include the u-axis, since v cannot equal 0, but we can have both positive and negative v-values. And that is it. Moving right along. If we look at example 5.1.2, given r of u, v equals the vector u plus v, u squared minus v, u plus v squared, determine if the point P equals 7, 5, 19 is on the surface. So this vector valued function in two variables is going to give us some sort of two-dimensional surface based on u and v. And we want to know if this point 7, 5, 19 is on that surface. That tells us that we want, well, the u plus v is my first component, so that would have to equal 7. The second component, u squared minus v, that would have to equal 5. And the third component, u plus v squared, would have to equal 19. Now what we're saying is, do there exist u and v values that we can plug in and make all three of these true so that this point is on the surface? So to do this, I'm going to go ahead and solve for u in the first equation, and then plug this into the second equation. See what happens here. We're going to get a v squared minus 14v plus 49 minus v equals 5. So this is v squared minus 15v plus 44 equals 0. Now let's see, does anything factor here? This is 2 and 22, 3 doesn't go in, 4 times 11. 4 times 11, 4 and 11 is going to give us a 15. So I have v minus 4, v minus 11 equals 0. So we have two options here, either v equals 4 or v equals 11. If I plug these in back here, we're going to get u equals 3 or negative 4. Keep in mind, this goes with v equals 4, and this is when v equals 11. We can't mix them up here. So we want to check, do either of these situations work in the third equation that we have here? So if v equals 4 and u equals 3, we get 3 plus 4 squared equals 19. Yes, that works. So we'll double check the other one. If v equals 11 and u equals negative 4, we get negative 4 plus 11 squared equals 117. That does not work. So we then say r of 3 comma 4. We see when I plug the 3 and the 4 in, we get 7 for the first component. We get 9 minus 4 is 5 for the second component, and we get 3 plus 16 is 19 for the third component. So that shows us that this point is on this surface, and it's on this surface when u is 3 and v is 4. Note that the u and the v values do not correspond with the x, y, or z values at all. We're going to talk more about what they mean and how we can see them on the surface in a little while. Go ahead and look at exercise 5.1.2. Work this out, pause the video, work it out on your own. I will be back to work it out with you shortly. And we're back. So we set up the three equations, setting the x, y, and z values of the point equal to the x, y, and z components of the function here. So u squared plus v equals 7, u minus v equals 5, v squared minus u equals 0. I went ahead, there's a lot of different ways you can do this, so as long as you got the same conclusion, then you're totally fine. We can be substituting in all sorts of different directions to be able to solve this equation. I took the middle one and solved for u, so u equals 5 plus v. I plugged that into both the equation on the left and the equation on the right. On the left, I got the quantity 5 plus v all squared plus v equals 7, which when I multiply this out, I get v squared plus 10v plus 25 plus v equals 7, which simplifies down to v squared plus 11v plus 18 equals 0. This does factor as v plus 9 times v plus 2 equals 0, which tells us that v equals negative 9 or v equals negative 2. Now in the equation on the right, when I plug in the u equals 5 plus v, we get v squared minus v minus 5 equals 0. This does not factor, but I can take the values that we found on the left-hand side and try them out on this right one to see if we get a true statement with either of these v values. So if we plug in a negative 9 into v squared minus v minus 5 equals 0, we get negative 9 squared, the quantity negative 9 squared, so that's parentheses negative 9. Close parentheses, squared, plus 9, minus 5, that does not equal 0, so negative 9 does not work in this equation. Trying v equals negative 2, we get the quantity negative 2 all squared plus 2 minus 5 also doesn't equal 0. So neither of these v values are going to give us a true statement in the third one. So whatever we have for u and v to make the first component equals to 7 will not allow us to have the third component equal to 0. So the point 750 is not on this surface. So let's move on to identifying and plotting parametric surfaces, section 5.2. We will investigate a few different ways of identifying and plotting parametric surfaces. And to start, we want to compare them to known equations of surfaces in three variables. Let us review some known equations of surfaces so that we can see how the parametric equations can be translated into known equations. Okay, so before we even get into still, I know everyone's wanting to know what is the u and the v and how are they going to show up on our graphs. Before we do that still, let's just review these surfaces given by equations in three variables. We have our cone in figure 5.2.1. which is given by the equation z squared over c squared equals x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared. We have figure 5.2.2, which is an ellipsoid. It's given by the equation x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared plus z squared over c squared equals 1. Note in both of these equations and the following equations, the a, the b, and the c are going to be stretch factors in the x, y, and z directions respectively. So if we're looking at the equation for the cone, if the a value gets bigger, then this is going to stretch my cone in the x direction by a factor of a. If b changes its value, this will stretch or shrink the magnitude of the cone in the y direction by a factor of b. And if c gets bigger or smaller, that will stretch or shrink the cone in the z direction. We can also do a shift here. If I plugged in for z, z minus 5, for example, that would shift the whole cone up 5. If I plugged in for x, x plus 2, that would shift it left 2 in the x direction. If I plugged in y minus 7 for y here, that would shift it right 7 units. Those shifts in the x, y, and z are the same for any of these. Let's keep on going here. We have Actually, before I keep going, let's talk about these equations and why they give us what they do. So, for the cone, if we cover up say the y squared over b squared, So if y is a, or rather than covering up, say y is a constant. Say y equals 1. We'll assume a, b, and c are 1 for this little purpose. Then we'll get z squared equals x squared plus 1. And rearranging this, we get z squared minus x squared equals 1. This is going to give us the equation of a hyperbola in z and x directions. So if we just changed our view of this so that we weren't seeing the y-axis, just the x and z-axis, we would get hyperbolas in that direction. If x were 1, then we would get the same kind of thing. We would get hyperbolas in the y and z direction. And then if z is a constant, say z is 1, then we're going to get circles or ellipses in the x and y direction if we're looking at this from the top. So we can kind of think of that. If we plug in a constant for any of the variables, we'll see what the shape looks like from one side. Here in the ellipsoid, if any of these are a constant, we're going to get ellipses in the other direction. So we have ellipses everywhere. Whoops. So if we scroll down here and look at figure 5.2.3, the elliptic paraboloid, we have z over c equals x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared. So here, if say y is 1, y equals 1 is going to give us z, something like z equals x squared plus 1, so we get parabolas. If z equals 1, we get something like 1 equals x squared plus y squared, so we see ellipses from the top. If x equals 1, we would get the same kind of thing, z equals y squared plus 1, so we see parabolas from the sides and ellipses from the top. Figure 5.2.4, the hyperbolic paraboloid. Say x equals 1, then we have z equals 1 minus y squared, so we see parabolas from the side here. If y equals 1, we would get z equals x squared minus 1, so we get negative parabolas from that side. If z equals 1, then we get 1 equals x squared minus y squared, so from the top we should see hyperbolas, thus the hyperbolic paraboloid. Our last two surfaces, figure 5.2.5, is a hyperboloid of one sheet. The equation is x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared minus z squared over c squared equals 1. If x is 1, we get y squared minus z squared equals 0. Let's not do x is 1. Let's try x is 2. Well, okay, let's talk about this. I'll just avoid it. So if x is 1, we get y squared minus z squared equals 0. This is just going to be straight line equations. This is y squared equals z squared. So z equals plus or minus y. So if x equals y 1, then from that direction we're going to see straight lines for our curve. That's going to be a little hard to see here, but okay, if x is 1, then this is kind of come through, hit this point, and then be this on this outer edge and that line there. So but if we have x is 2, we're going to get hyperbola. So if x is 2, then I'm going to get y squared minus z squared equals negative 1. Or wait, no, 4, negative 3. Right, so if I plug in 2 here, I get a 4, I subtract it over, I get this, but this is going to give me hyperbolas when we move out farther. We're going to get a hyperbola here and a hyperbola here when x is 2. If y is a constant, we're going to get the same kind of thing in the other direction, so we're also going to get hyperbolas. If z is a constant, say z equals 2, then we're going to get x squared plus y squared equals 5, so we get ellipses from the top. Now, same kind of thing in figure 5.2.6. It's a hyperboloid of two sheets. We see in the picture that the middle has been pinched off so that there's a gap between the top and bottom half of the shape. The equation is negative x squared over a squared minus y squared over b squared plus z squared over c squared equals 1. Do not know how that typo happened. Fix that. So if x equals 1 here, that's going to add over, and we're going to get negative y squared plus z squared equals 2. So we get hyperbolas again, because this is really a subtraction. If y equals 1, we'll get the same kind of thing, but from the other side, also hyperbolas. If z equals 1, then we'll get negative x squared minus y squared equals 1, equals 0. This just gives us the point when x is 0 and y is 0. That's going to be the very bottom of this right here. If z is negative 1, we'll end up with this point right here. If z equals 2, then we're going to get negative x squared minus y squared equals negative 3. So the negatives will cancel and we will get ellipses in that kind of situation. If z is 0, we're going to get negative x squared minus y squared equals 1, and this has no solutions. That's what's causing this gap right here. On the other hand, for figure 5.2.5, with our hyperboloid of one sheet, if z is 0 over here, we'll get x squared plus y squared equals 1. This does have a solution. So the position of the negatives from these two equations is what causes all of a sudden this gap to happen if z is small numbers, where when we subtract it from the other side, if this ends up being a negative or a positive. So those are our six basic surfaces. We're going to look at how those can be translated into parametric equations now. Okay, example 5.2.1, identify and sketch the surface given by R of u, v equals the vector u, v, u squared minus v squared. This one's pretty straightforward. I have x equals u, y equals v, z equals u squared minus v squared. But x is u and y is v, so I can plug those in and get x squared minus y squared here, and see that this is actually the equation of my hyperbolic paraboloid. Here, figure 5.2.4, z equals x squared minus y squared with c, a, and b all equaling 1. So it's my standard hyperbolic paraboloid. So if I want to graph this, say I have x equals plus or minus 1. This is going to give me z equals negative y squared plus 1. So just putting my axes names on here. If x is 1 or negative 1, we have a parabola that's downward facing and shifted up 1. So, and over here, same thing. Now, if y equals, let's do a different color here. Actually, let's do one other thing. If x equals 0, that's a nice one to have on there. Then we have z equals negative y squared, right? Let's draw that one also. So that one's right here, starting from the origin. Like so. Now let's switch colors. Switch it up. If y equals 0, then I have z equals x squared. So we're going to get a parabola like this going through these three points. If y equals plus or minus 1, we're going to get z equals x squared minus 1. So it's a upward facing parabola shifted down 1. And here we then get upward facing. This guy, I'm taking this y is negative 1 here, going straight over to my red lines for the downward ones, and knowing that those are going to cross there. Here, y is 1, but down 1. This scale's not the greatest. It's going to be somewhere like right here. And we're going to get this upward facing parabola. Here, like so. And then this is just going to keep happening. If I want to go ahead and fill some in detail in, I'm just going to pause the video and fill in some detail because I'm not going to talk through all of it, and I'll describe what I have after the fact. Okay, the last thing I added was kind of these, the hyperbolas that we get if we were looking from the top. So I have actually, come back behind here. So this hyperbola we would get when z equals 1. If z equals 1/2, we're going to get a hyperbola like this. If z is negative 1, we're going to get this hyperbola in this direction. So I'm just trying to get the picture to look something like this, right? Where I've got my hyperbolas here and my hyperbolas here, like so, to go along with the parabolas to kind of help us visualize this. So the key thing here is just give your picture some tender, loving care. Try it a few times. It's not the easiest thing to draw, but give it a shot. See what you can't make come out. Try some of the techniques that I've tried here. All right, for exercise 5.2.1, this one's a little bit different. Identify and sketch the surface given by r of u, comma v equals the vector cosine of u, comma v, comma sine of u. A couple of hints for you. Note that the u is just in the x and the z components, and the v is my y component, so that could give us some indication of what's going on here. Play around with it, see if you can't figure out what's going on, and then we're going to go on to using grid curves to be able to graph these. So I will work through the solution with you in just a few moments. Pause the video, give this a shot. All right, so the solution here is that since x equals cosine of u and z equals sine of u, we get circles in the x and z direction. These have a radius 1 because the coefficients are just 1. So our y equals v is a free variable, so that allows us to just take the circles that we see in x and z and extend them in the y direction freely. So we're going to get a cylinder, circular, with the y-axis being the axis of symmetry. It's got a radius of 1, so I've gone ahead and drawn that here. And another thing here when we have this exercise is this isn't meant to be a really complicated shape because we want you to be able to figure out what it is. The hyperbolic paraboloid that we have above is pretty much the hardest kind of thing we're going to get at this point. With the grid curves, we can do a little bit more complicated things, but let's go ahead and scroll down and get to talking about those. Definition 5.2.1, the grid curves of a parametric surface are the lines created when one of the parameters of the vector-valued function in two parameters is held constant so that it becomes a vector-valued function in one parameter. Note that we can use GeoGebra to graph parametric surfaces. While I will use grid curves in the next example to sketch the surface so you can see how we can do this without a computer, I've also graphed the surface in GeoGebra so that we can see the grid curves there as well and confirm the accuracy of my sketch. The syntax for entering this parametric surface into GeoGebra is, so here, let's just run through this. R of u comma v equals, this is how we're typing this into GeoGebra. You type surface, parentheses, type out your x component, put a comma, type your y component, comma, type your z component, then put a comma, you're going to put your first parameter. So say we're using u, we would write u, and then we would do the first input parameter start value and the first input parameter end value. So if we want u to go from negative 5 to 5, we would put negative 5, comma 5 here. The second input parameter, generally v, we'd type that, comma, the second input parameter start value, the second input parameter end value. We would put, say we want v to go from negative 8 to 8, we would put negative 8 for the start value and 8 for the end value for the second parameter. So for the next example, this would look like r of u comma v equals surface, parentheses u squared comma v minus u comma v squared minus u comma negative 10 comma 10 comma v comma negative 10 comma negative 10. So my first component u squared, second component is v minus u, third component is v squared minus u, and my first component is u, and we want that to go from negative 10 to 10. My second component is v, also having that go from negative 10 to 10. So that's our syntax. So if you want to graph anything, go ahead and follow that example. So let's look at example 5.2.2. Let r of u comma v equal the vector 2u comma u squared plus v squared comma 3v. Use grid curves to sketch the parametric surface. Okay, so the idea here for a grid curve is that if we keep a variable constant, let's say u equals 0, then what do we get? So we have r of 0 comma v equals the vector 0 comma v squared comma 3v. Let's get my x, my y, my z here. And so if I'm looking at this curve, we want to be able to graph this as a line on here, and we're going to just do this for a bunch of different values of u, then we're going to switch and do it for some values of v, be able to draw the lines, and then hopefully get a picture of what this graph looks like. So if I have, well, this is going to be a parabola in y and z, so I can actually put that, So y equals v squared, z equals 3v. So this gives us that, v equals 1/3 z. So I can plug this in over for y and get y equals 1/9 z squared. So we get, starting at the origin, if z is 1 or negative 1, then we get y is 1/9. If z is 3 or negative 3, we're going to get y is 1. So this is going to be expanding really slowly over here. Y is 1. If z is negative 3, then we get negative 3 squared is 9, over 9 is 1. Same thing if z is 3. So we're going to get y is 1, z is 3. Gives us this point. We know it's a parabola. So we're going to get this parabolic shape, which is going to be the same on the bottom half. Something like this. Now if I have u equals 1, then we get r of 1 comma v equals 2 comma v squared plus 1 comma 3v still. Here we can do a similar thing where we get y equals v squared plus 1, z still equals 3v, or v equals 1/3 z. So if we plug that in, we get 1 ninth z squared plus 1. So we're getting the same parabola, except for it shifted plus 1 in the y direction. So this is, we note also that x is 2 here. So if x is 2, then we shift up in the y direction by 1. This entire parabola that we'd graphed before. So the previous parabola that we graphed, we shift it 2 to the right in the x direction, 1 back in the y direction, and get a parabola that looks like this. Okay, so let's let u equal negative 1. I'm going to be more careful with my space here. I'm going to adjust some things. Okay, so if u equals negative 1, we get r of negative 1 comma v equals negative 2 in the x direction. When we square negative 1, we still get v squared plus 1 for our y component, and we still get 3v for our z component. So we're going to get the same parabola that we got a second ago, except for x is now negative 2. So we go negative 2 in the x direction, 1 in the y direction. That should be my vertex, and then we follow the same shape that we'd used before, using the y equals 1 ninth z squared plus 1. A parabola here. Okay, now let's switch and do in the v direction. I'll switch colors so we can kind of see the difference here. V equals 0, we get r of u comma 0 equals 2u comma u squared comma 0. Now we're going to get parabolas in x and y. So we have 2u equals x gives u equals 1 half x. I can plug that into the y component to get y equals 1 quarter x squared. And so if x is 0, note that for this, z is 0, so we're going to have the origin. And then we're going to graph starting at the origin in the xy plane, y equals 1 quarter x squared. If x is 2, y is 1. It's going to give me that point. If x is negative 2, y is 1, gives me this point here. So we get this. Get a sideways parabola in the plane. Okay, and then if we have v equals 1, we get r of u comma 1 equals still 2u. When v is 1, that's not going to change my x component. My y component is now u squared plus 1. My z component is now 3. So we'll be up when z is 3 now. We'll be graphing what looks like is going to be a parabola again because x is 2u and y is u squared plus 1. So we have a parabolic relationship here. But we're going to do this in the plane z equals 3. So x is still equals 2u, so u equals 1 half x still. We plug that now into y equals u squared plus 1 to get y equals 1 quarter x squared plus 1. So we graph y equals 1 quarter x squared plus 1 in the z equals 3 plane. So we're going to get x is 0, y is 1, z is 3. It's this point. And then we go ahead and graph our parabola here. And lastly, we'll do v equals negative 1. So we have r of u comma negative 1 equals 2u comma u squared still plus 1 comma now z is negative 3. So we're going to get the same picture that we just got, but in the z equals negative 3 plane. graphing y equals 1 quarter x squared plus 1 because the relationship between x and y has not changed. So we're actually not going to see this in the way that we have the scale here, but it's going to be below in the same amount that we saw the parabola that we just graphed. So down about where we have our caption for this. So hopefully already we're seeing what shape this is, though. And hopefully you're getting an idea of what these grid curves are doing. So the grid curves allow us to see when u is constant, what kind of space curve we get on the surface by allowing v to change. When v is constant, we get space curves on the surface that are shown when v is constant and u is allowed to change. Here, hopefully, you're able to see that this is giving us a parabolic ellipsoid. We have parabolas in x and y, and we have parabolas in y and z. And if we look at it from the side, it looks like we have ellipses here. Let's go ahead and look at the graph in GeoGebra, and we'll be able to switch some views around. And you see the same grid curves here. So we have, these are actually slightly different grid curves that GeoGebra has decided to graph. But we get that this same kind of thing is happening. We're getting when z is 6, we have the grid curve here. That's going to correspond to when, let's see my equation, so 3v, so if z is 6, v is 2. So if v is 2, we get this grid curve. If v is negative 2, we'll get this grid curve down here where we see that z, actually I'm misseeing this. It looks like if I go straight from the side, this grid curve is when z is 5, so v equals 5 over 3 by plugging in z equals 3v. And then this one when z is negative 5, so that's when v equals negative 5 over 3. And that's the curve that we would get. These curves that are parabolas in z and y, looks like this one is when y equals 2, or actually it's easier to look at it this way, when x equals 3-ish, no, a little bit bigger than that. But we could solve that as well if we could tell exactly what x value that was and figure out what u is to know what space curve or grid curve is being graphed for that line. But we could do this for all the u and the v and get lines that are in between the lines that are shown, and all together we get this surface. Now here we're kind of cutting off half of it, but that's only because of the view. So there we go, we're seeing that other half now. We can zoom out and see that, yes, this is a parabolic ellipsoid. If I look at it from the side, there are actually ellipses in the x, z direction, but those aren't actually grid curves. Okay. So for you, I'm not going to have you go ahead and do all of the grid curves in the same way, but you're going to have to kind of do some of this to match these graphs. You can open this up in GeoGebra if you want to, but we have four different parabolic surfaces given by vector-valued functions in two variables. So exercise 5.2.2, match the following vector equations to their respective graphs. The first equation, A, is p of u comma v equals the vector u comma v comma u times v. The next one, b, q of u comma v equals the vector u squared times cosine of v comma u squared times sine of v comma u. The next one, c, r of u comma v equals the vector 2 sine of v cosine of u comma 2 sine of v sine of u comma 2 cosine of v. The last one, d, is s of u comma v equals the vector sine of v comma cosine of u sine of 2v comma sine of u times sine of 2v. And this specific vector equation is when v is between negative pi and pi. Then we're given four graphs. Figure 5.2.8 is the first graph, graph capital I, view graph using GeoGebra. And this is a graph of a hyperbola. I'm sorry, a hyperbolic paraboloid, rather. So if you look at it, you have hyperbolas if you look down in the xy plane, and you have parabolas if you look in the side views. The figure 5.2.9 is my graph capital II, which is a sphere centered at the origin. My third graph is figure 5.2.10, capital I. And this looks almost like a barbell. It's two circular, how I want to put it. If we looked at it from the YZ direction, we would have circles that when X is, all right, so if I look at the first vector equation here, P of U comma V equals U comma V comma U times V, we get, if U is 0, we get the vector 0, V, 0, where Y equals V. So as V is allowed to roam, this just gives us Y values, but the X and Z values are 0, so this is just the Y axis. On the other hand, V equals 0, we get the vector U comma 0 comma 0, since X equals U in this case, and Y and 0, or Y and Z are 0, this gives us just the x-axis. If we look below, the only graph that matches this, that has the x-axis and the y-axis as part of the graph, is figure 5.2.8, capital I. So this hyperbolic paraboloid includes the x-axis and y-axis. If we look at all the other graphs, they do not contain all of the x-axis and y-axis. So this is the only one that can match that. If we look at the second equation for part B, Q of U comma V equals U squared times cosine of V comma U squared times sine of V comma U. So here I'm letting V equal 0. I thought about setting U equals 0, but that just gives me the point 0, 0, 0. I have two different graphs that match that, both figure 5.2.10, capital III, and figure 5.2.11, capital IV, include the origin. So that wouldn't give me enough knowledge to know which graph it is. So I chose V as 0 instead. I got the vector U squared comma U comma 0. This gives X equals U squared and Z equals 0. Now, if we put those together, we get X equals Z squared, and capital IV, figure 5.2.11, is the only graph with the parabola X equals Z squared. So we must have that this matches figure 5.2.11. Looking at part C, we have the vector equation R of U comma V equals 2 sine of V cosine of U comma 2 sine of V sine of U comma 2 cosine of V. The quick way of seeing the answer here is that this is spherical coordinates exactly. Normally spherical coordinates is X equals rho sine of phi cosine of theta, Y equals rho sine of phi sine of theta, Z equals rho cosine of phi. So here we're just saying V is phi and U equals theta, and rho is a constant 2. Since rho is a constant 2, this has to give the graph of a sphere. So this goes with figure capital II. Our last one, part D, S of U comma V equals the vector sine of V comma cosine of U sine of 2V comma sine of U times sine of 2V. This, if we set U equal to 0, we get the vector sine of V comma sine of 2V comma 0. So this is saying if we're in the xy plane, we have that X is sine of V and Y is sine of 2V. Since in the Y component we have sine of 2V instead of just V, that means that we're moving in the Y direction twice as fast as we are in the X direction. How I have it worded here, moving twice as fast in the Y direction, so we must have an infinity shape instead of circles. Normally if we just had sine of V, this would just be a line moving back and forth, but since we're moving twice as fast in the Y direction, we're able to get up and down as X moves from negative 1 to 1, Y moves from negative 1 to 1 twice. So as X moves from negative 1 across to 1, Y moves from negative 1. I'm sorry, so if we go a full period, as X goes from negative 1 to positive 1 back to negative 1, Y goes from negative 1 to positive 1 to negative 1 to positive 1 twice. Okay, so we get that infinity shape. So if we look at figure 5.2.10, capital II, if we look it down on the xy plane, we see that we would get that same infinity shape, and none of the rest of these are going to have that. So this is not by process of elimination. This is saying that, right, I don't want you to say, oh, because the other three graphs are already taken, it must match this one. I still want us to have a reason, like I have here, for why this must, that figure 5.2.10 goes with part D, the function S. All right. Moving on to the last page, section 5.3, parameterizing equations of surfaces. It is sometimes convenient to take the equation of a surface and turn it into a vector function in two variables to be able to analyze in a different manner or to satisfy the requirements of some software you are using. Or you may have the idea for a shape without an equation. You want to be able to come up with a vector function in two variables to represent it. This can also be useful for determining volumes of objects, which we will look at in later chapters. In other words, if we have some description of a surface and we want to find the equations of it, or if we have, say, the first thing that we've got, example 5.3.1, find a parametric representation for the part of the elliptic paraboloid, x plus y squared plus 2z squared equals 4, that lies in front of the plane x equals 0. So we have a surface given in a standard xyz form. We want to look at the same surface in a parameterized form, and then we want to be able to limit the values of the inputs so that we're only looking at the part of it that's in front of the plane x equals 0. I'm going to start by dividing both sides of my equation by 4, so I get x over 4 plus y squared over 4 plus z squared over 2 equals 1. As I'm thinking about this, that's not what I want to do. I want, if we go back and think about our elliptic paraboloids, I'm scrolling back up here, I want to say, okay, my elliptic paraboloid, I really want to have the variable without the squared isolated on one side of the equation and not have a constant. So I'm going to go back, and that's the form that I want to go for. In the equation that we're looking at here, x is the variable that doesn't have a square. So I'm going to go ahead and isolate x. So x equals, so let's see, I'm going to bring the 4 over to one side, x minus 4 equals the y squared and plus 2z squared over to the other, minus y minus 2z squared. If I divide everything by 2, oops, I squared there, I have x minus 4 over 2 equals negative y squared, I'm going to factor out a negative on that right side also, over 2 plus z squared. If I compare this to our original z over c equals x squared over a squared plus y squared over b squared, we see here that the 2 is going to stretch this in the x direction. The minus 4 shifts it to the right 4 units. The axis of symmetry is the x-axis. It's not shifted in the y or z at all. The negative here is going to make it a negative paraboloid, so it goes towards the yz plane from x's positive 4. And sketch what I'm saying here. If x is 4, let's see, green, sure, there's my y-axis, then we're going to have it's going to look like this. And we want this in front of the plane x equals 0, so we just want to keep it on the right side of the yz plane. All right, so we're going to do something a little bit fancy. We see that y squared over 2 plus z squared, if this equals 1, then this will give me the equation of ellipse. But this can change, right, depending on what we have for y and z. So if y squared over 2 plus z squared, This is going to equal something, let's call it V, right? So V can change. So we're going to get grid curves that are ellipses now from this. So if that's the case, we have y squared over 2v plus z squared over v equals 1. And this gives us ellipses with y radius square root of 2v and z radius of square root of v. So we can parametrize ellipses by saying that y equals the square root of 2v times the cosine of some other variable theta, but let's choose u now. Z now equals the square root of v times sine of u. Okay. And what we've also done by setting it up this way, we've now said that x minus 4 over 2 equals negative v, because we chose y squared over 2 plus z squared equals v. This implies that x equals negative 2v plus 4. So we can get we have our parameterization here. If I want to write this as a vector function, r of u comma v now equals negative 2v plus 4 comma square root of 2v cosine of u comma square root of v sine of u. And I didn't ask you to do this, but we can go ahead and graph both of these surfaces. Here I have my original x plus y squared plus 2z squared equals 4, and now we have the surface that where I've done my parametric equations, and we see that we do in fact get the same surface. So for this practice, it's not a bad idea of graphing them both in GeoGebra to ensure that you've parameterized correctly. I actually forgot the 2 when I plugged this in here. I had a slightly different graph. If we see this, we see they're not the same, so I knew I'd made a mistake, and it took me a second to realize, as I double-checked my paperwork versus what I'd entered, that I'd forgot that too. And I also was seeing that, oh, the x's need to be stretched a little bit here, so that was, it's like, that might be an easy solution, is to stretch these x's. So that made me double-check that, and saw that I just needed to do that, and sure enough, it worked out great. All right, let's look at the next example, 5.3.2. We see we've just got two more left in this lecture here. Example 5.3.2, parameterize a circular cone with an interior angle of 45 degrees. So let's just draw this real quick. This is, if here's the x-axis, and here's the z-axis. Quick sketch. Then from the side, we want it to look really like this x, except for we have these circles. Here, and we have the circles where if I was looking down from the z-axis into the xy plane, we would see circles from above. Go ahead and draw a y-axis in here. So, how do we want to think about this? Well, from above, we have the circle, so we know that we have x squared plus y squared equals some radius squared. And that radius is going to change as z changes. So we have to think about how is the radius related to my z value here. Well, since this is a 45 degree angle here, new color, let's do pink. Since this is 45 degrees between the xy plane and the bottom of the cone, or the surface of the cone, that means we have to have a one-to-one relationship between the z value on the cone and the x value on the cone. So we have, at least when y is 0, we have z equals x. So if I plug in z equals x and y equals 0, I get z squared equals r squared. So z equals r. Now, if I have this equation for my circles, x squared plus y squared equals r squared, then we can parameterize this as x equals r cosine of theta and y equals r sine of theta. So here we get a parameterization of x equals r cosine of theta, y equals r sine of theta, and c equals r. If we wanted to do this as a vector function, let's not use r since that's already being used here. Let's say s of u, comma v. And we don't have to switch it to u and v. I'm just so used to it here, where we have u is the radius, u cosine of v, so v is the angle, u sine of v, and then my z component is u. And that would be my vector function for the same thing. Okay, so this says exercise 5.3.1. If you want to go ahead and pause the video and see if you can't work out how to do a rotation here, at least look at it for a little bit. See if you can't come up with something. If you get totally stuck, no worries. I'm going to work through this in just a few moments. All right, exercise 5.3.1, find parametric equations for the surface obtained by rotating the curve y equals e to the negative x over the interval from x is 0 to x is 3 about the x-axis and use them to graph the surface, we'll say in GeoGebra, as that's what we're using this term. So let's see here. Oh, there we go. Okay, so when I'm doing this, I'm going to let x equals u be one of the parameterizations, so we want to limit u to be from 0 to 3. Now we have y equals e to the negative u, but this is when we have z equal to 0. That is, we're really thinking of this in x and y equals e to the negative x. So that's in the xy plane when z equals 0. When we rotate, we're getting circles around the x-axis. So we get circles in y and z. So we have y squared plus z squared equals r squared. So we could parameterize these circles to be y equals r cosine of theta and z equals r sine of theta. Now we just want to see that the radius is equal to my y equals e to the u, right? So that e to the u piece, expression, is our radius. The way that we can see that is now that z equals 0, now when z equals 0, we have z equals r sine of theta, so this implies that theta equals 0 because the radius is not 0 here. Now if theta equals 0 and we plug that into y equals r cosine of theta, we get y equals just r because cosine of 0 is 1. But we know that y equals e to the negative u. This implies that r equals e to the negative u. So if I plug that back in for my parameterization of y and z, we get y equals e to the negative u cosine of theta, z equals e to the negative u sine of theta. If we switch theta to v, then we get that our vector function is s of u comma v equals the vector u comma e to the negative u cosine of v comma e to the negative u sine of v. And we can go ahead and look at the graph here. Here I have exactly that plugged in. I have my u values from 0 to 3, just as requested. And that cuts so that our shape here does not extend, oh, there we go, zoom out, past x is 0 or x is 3. And I have for my v from 0 to 2 pi, so I get a full rotation. All right, that is everything for this lesson. Thank you so much for listening and watching, and I will talk to you in the next lesson. Have a great one.